Amen. Good morning, church. Y'all stand with us.
Better than night. If you've made it here today, you're a testimony of God's kindness. Amen.
Amen.
Let's just give him our praise and adoration for all the things that he's done for us. Amen.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. And all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will see the goodness.
Let's sing that again.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. And all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head, oh, I will see the goodness of God. You have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I have made, oh, I will see the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have been in the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful. You have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will see the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running.
Constant and steadfast.
And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will see of the goodness.
Let's sing that one more time. Just completely humble, broken before him. With everything that we have, give thanks and adoration.
All my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so. The goodness of God. Yes, I will sing of the goodness of God. Yes, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Amen.
And good morning, Coast Community Church. God is good, yeah? And all the time God is good? Yes? Give him a round of applause, please. Good to have you here today. Members, regular attenders, visitors alike, let's give our visitors a round of applause as well. We also welcome those who are joining us by live streaming. Very much glad that you have joined us. It's a wonderful day. The weather is awesome. Not too hot. Not too cold. It's great. I hope your life is going well. Remember, though, if your life's going well, God's with you. And when your life isn't going so well, God is still with you. You can't escape God, and that's a good thing. No matter where you run, no matter where you go, you can't get away from God. And since you can't, might as well just turn around and say, here I am. Deal with me, Lord. And that's what we want God to do. Deal with us. As far as announcements are concerned, we have a couple that we need to share. We are going to pass around the offering bag as I share in announcements as we contribute our tithing and our gifts and our offerings to God. We thank you for sharing, giving back to God a piece of what he has given to you. If you are visiting, though, you do not need to feel one shred of obligation to give during our time of tithing, gifts, and offerings. Why? Because we're just glad that you chose to be with us this morning. Now, on the issue of announcements, Christmas stuff's going to be getting here really soon. October's almost over. And once October's over, you are definitely in the holiday season. So we'll be giving you announcements and updates in regard to decorating the facility, decorating the grounds, and things of that nature. We'll let you know times and dates for that. It can be a pretty extensive process, and we will give you information and times and what needs to be accomplished. And yes, everybody would be welcome to help. Children, teens, and adults. I do know that tonight there is Red Letter Bible Study at Rebecca's home at 6 o'clock. It is for ladies. If you're not really understanding what Red Letter Bible Study is, when you read the Bible, certain translations, certain books have all of Jesus' words in red. So they are studying the red words, the red letters, which are the words of Christ in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. They would love to have you. Like I said, that's at 6 o'clock tonight. We do thank you for picking up all the boxes for the Operation Christmas Child program. We had 50 of them. They've all been taken. Many have already been returned. On that note, according to this from Rebecca, half have already been turned in. We need the rest of them no later than November the 11th. November the 11th. We have had a couple of folks be very generous and helpful and completely cover the cost of those 50 boxes shipping. It costs $10 per box just to get them shipped in the places of the world that they need to go to. So it was $500, and we've had two folks in the church who have generously donated to cover that $500 so that we could get that. That's awesome. That's good. Really good. And we don't want you to think that we can't acquire more boxes. We've already done 50. If you need more, if you want more, we can get more. That's not a problem at all. We can acquire more boxes. Like I said, 50 have already been taken. We could do another 10, 15, 20 if you would like to. Just let Rebecca know if she needs to get some more boxes, and we will make sure that happens. If you haven't picked which child, type of child, age of child, gender of child, that you are going to create your boxes for, we have some suggestions. We need 2 to 4-year-olds, both boys and girls. 2 to 4-year-olds, both boys and girls. 10 to 14-year-old boys and 5 to 9-year-old boys. So we're very in great and heavy need for the boy realm to be taken care of. But it's both girls and boys for age 2 to 4, boys 10 to 14, boys 5 to 9. So if you haven't already decided who you're going to make your box for and already started buying stuff for it, this would be very helpful if you could note those genders and age brackets. That would be fantastic. Let me see if there's anything else in particular I need to share with you today. Not that I can think of. I think that covers the announcements we need to share in. We do want to go to God in prayer. But before we do, I just want to mention that Miss Beth told me a while ago that her dad fell. And it was a significant fall. He has broken at least 4 ribs. He is in ICU. They're trying to determine best course of action, what to do with him. He's not a young man. And he's kind of on the frail side to begin with. Now he has 4 broken ribs. And he's having a difficult time breathing, getting enough oxygen in his lungs. Also, the number of times he's breathing is not the proper number of times. So he's in not great shape. He actually is in ICU. Their fear could be that one of the broken ribs could puncture something in the chest. So don't know what the outcome will be yet or what they plan to do. So be in prayer for Beth's dad, that doctors and nurses and so forth will figure out how they can best help this gentleman. So anyway, we pray for him today. There are still many people. I got a couple of phone calls and texts this morning. People are not feeling well. Sickliness is going around. Unfortunately, flu's going around. Stomach virus is going around. And strep is going around. So there you go. Take your pick. One of those 3 or, better option, none of the above. None of the above. Best option. Speak against that. We want option 4. So let's go ahead and have the offering bag come forward. We'll pray for our offering and pray before our God and share with him our hearts. Lord God, we thank you for this day that you have granted us, that you have made, that you have created, that you have, this day, Lord, has been waiting since the beginning of time to arrive. And here it is. And this day will come, and this day will go. May we lift you up in this day. Praise you in this day. Worship you in this day. Be with us in spirit and in truth and in power. Open our minds and our hearts and our souls and our spirits to you. May we give you the honor that you are due. We pray for everyone here this morning, those watching by live stream, those who could not be here this morning. We pray for those who are sick at the present time and for healing, who are having a rough time in life, for direction and power and peace. We pray for Beth's dad. Not in good shape, Lord, and you know that better than we do. So we pray for guidance with the doctors, wisdom, patience, and how best to handle his fall, his broken ribs, and treatment. So we just lift him up and the family up in Jesus' name. Lord God, there's so many things in life that go on, and you know them all. So anything today that we have not addressed or talked about or lifted up to you, you know what our needs are, what our hurts are, what our fears are. Holy Spirit, come. Enlighten our hearts. Give wisdom to our minds. And may we feel your glory. We pray today, Lord, for tithing, the giving, and the offering, the money that has been presented. Lord, it's just a small part of all the blessing and all the wonderful things that you have given to us. We cannot outgive you, Lord. You are a great God. We pray for the offering and tithes and to be presented for your ministry, for your outreach, for your mission, for your kingdom. We pray all things today, Lord God. In Jesus' holy name, the name above all names. The people of God said amen. 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 Okay, ladies and gentlemen, this morning we want to share with you Miss Julie has been a part of our church here for a long, long time. Long, long, long time. And we love Julie. And we're glad to have Julie. And there was a man that came into her life quite some time ago. And they fell in love and had every intention of getting married. His name, Philip Greg Sexton. He was extremely attentive to Julie. Extremely attentive. And I was impressed with that level of attention and concern and care that he gave to her. They started attending our church here at Coast Community and had gone to some men's events and had decided this was going to be his church home. Back last April, he had a massive, massive heart attack, and he did not live long at all. It was very, very quick from the time that it happened to the time that he breathed his last breath. And today, we just want to take some moments and some time here to thank God for Philip. Thank God for Julie. Thank God for their relationship and their attentiveness to one another. Does she miss him? That goes without saying. Does she still hurt? That goes without saying. But this is most important. What do we know about Philip that can actually give us peace and joy? He was a saved man. The most important thing that we need to consider when people pass on, did they know Jesus or did they not? Were they saved or were they not? That matters. Philip was a saved man. And one of the things I did appreciate about him in some of our conversations was he always wanted to know what it really meant to be a Christian. Like, how should a Christian act? What should a Christian do? What does it look like when a Christian is doing what a Christian is supposed to do? And how can that be more prevalent where people, he was mostly talking about himself, but we talked about, you know, life and people in general, was how do you not keep messing up? How do you finally walk with God like you're supposed to and really be a Christian? Don't just talk like one. So we had conversations like that. Those are wonderful conversations. And something I'm sure that we all think about, but don't probably talk about as much as we should. What does it mean to really live out a Christian life? Not just getting saved. And I told him, what you're talking about is the difference between Savior and Lord. If we give our lives to Jesus and get washed in his blood, we become saved people, saved from hell, saved from sin. But then we have to move a little further into our relationship with Jesus, and he has to become Lord, to where what he wants is what we do. What he says is what we hear. What he wants, we listen, and we go forth. So it goes from just making Jesus a Savior to Savior and Lord. There's Philip up on the screen. Jack of all trades, handyman, had enough knowledge to handle things and maybe enough knowledge just to get him in a little bit of trouble. Sometimes that's true for all of us. So we know enough to do something, and sometimes we know not enough that, make sure, I don't think I'm going to touch that today. Very handy man. But again, most impressive thing for me in dealing with him was inquiry about true Christianity and his concern for Miss Julie. I have some scriptures that I want to read, but before we do, Miss Julie wrote a poem, and she asked if she could read it, and I said, sure, not a problem at all. So, Miss Julie, you'll come up here. This microphone should be on. I'll let you share the poem that you wrote right here. I think it's on. If it's not, we can make it. Yep, it's on.
This poem's called Angel Wings. Angels have wings that are very so beautiful. They glisten when they fly across the water, and they have wings of purple, yellow, and orange. And I asked my man of my dreams, why don't angels touch the ground? And he didn't have an answer for that. So, I can't see. So one day, I got my answer. And then my man of my dreams died. There was my answer why the angels don't touch the ground, because the angels touch the ground when they call him to be with Jesus.
Three scriptures I want to read. First one, Julie picked out herself. The righteous perish, and no one takes it to heart. The devout are taken away, and no one understands that the righteous are taken away to be spared from evil. Those who walk uprightly enter into peace. They find rest even as they lie in death. And then from the collection of the Psalms. The Lord, He is my shepherd. Therefore I lack nothing. He makes me to lie down in pastures that are green, and He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for His name's sake. And even though I should walk through the darkest of valleys, I will fear no evil. For You are with me, Your rod and Your staff, they comfort me. And You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies, and You anoint my head with oil. Surely my cup overflows. Your goodness and Your love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Some red letters. Jesus' words. John 14. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, I would have told you. And I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I'm going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. So how can we know the way? Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. We may not, ladies and gentlemen, always agree with God's plan. And this is what I know many people have said, even well-meaning saved Christians. I just don't think it's fair. That what if somebody doesn't really want to believe in Jesus? Does that make them a bad person? Then they don't get to go to heaven. It is not for us, really, to question the plans of God. What God wants is what God should get. What God wants is what God is going to get. Our job, Julie's job, Philip's job while he was living, to share the good news that is Jesus and give people the opportunity to say yes or no to the King of Glory. And then, as Philip would suggest, once you've gotten to know him, what does the Christian life look like after that? Miss Julie requested that we sing Amazing Grace. So Mr. Josh here is going to lead us in Amazing Grace.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. This grace that brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. When we've been there,
Miss Julie, would you come down front for me, please? Joel, if you'll come down, please. You'll just get the anointing oil, anoint her. We're going to pray for Miss Julie. Lord God, we thank you for life. We thank you for creation. We thank you for the breath of life. We thank you for salvation in the blood of King Jesus. We thank you for your gifts that you give. We thank you for your blessings, your anointing. We thank you, Jesus, for dying and rising from the grave. We thank you, Jesus, that you sit at the right hand of God, the Almighty Father. We thank you for the life of Philip that you ordained, that you created, that you gave. We ask that you give Julie shalom, peace, comfort, confidence, and some joy that Philip knew Jesus. Touch her heart, touch her body, touch her mind. Give her your healing and your strength. Give her the courage to go boldly forward and to truly figure out, as Philip would have asked, what does being a Christian look like? We pray for Julie today. We pray for Philip today. We've given Philip to you in your arms and in your care. But likewise, Julie's still with us, and we give her to you. And we pray all things in the name of the Lord of Lords, the King of Glory, the risen Christ, Jesus. Amen. We're going to close together. We're going to close together with a song that the majority of you know. I learned it when I was in seminary in Evanston, Illinois, from my mentor, Bob Tuttle. And we used to sing it in every class that we met. He taught evangelism classes, Holy Spirit classes, and pastoral care classes. And we always sang this song. Whoa, whoa, whoa. There's power in the name of Jesus. Whoa, whoa, whoa. There's power in Jesus' name. Whoa, whoa, whoa. There's power in the name of Jesus. Whoa, whoa. There's power in Jesus' name. Whoa, 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 whoa. There's power in the name of Jesus. Whoa, 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 whoa. There's power in Jesus' name. Whoa, 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 whoa. There's power in the name of Jesus. Whoa, 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 whoa. There's power in Jesus' name. Whoa, whoa, whoa. There's power in the name of Jesus. Whoa, whoa. There's power in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. All right. Apologies for technical difficulties. Really, my slowness. This is going to be fun. So during mission trip, we had opportunities to be able to share and speak and learn and grow. And we entitled it our table talk sessions. And at the same time, Wednesday nights have kind of, I can only speak for the adult side because I'm not a child, but I am a child of God. On the adult side, it has become more of a discipleship, so it has been open dialogue. And with that, the fun part, I'm going to ask that whatever fivefold we have to come up here and join and bring whatever resources necessary, i.e. A Bible, maybe some water, coffee, a phone, because we are going to have Q&A. Okay. So with that, you guys want to make your way down? I know they're so excited. They were prepped for it and ready. And this Q&A is actually going to come from you, the body. So if there is something you want to know from Scripture, theological point of view, if you just need some encouragement in something, this is your time. Got it. Good. Yeah. Okay. So. My dearest and best is going to be King Chief Mike Holder.
Yay!
So if you have a question, just raise your hand and she will make her way to you. And let's begin. This is going to be fun.
A Okay, so my question is, what would be a scripture for somebody who is saved but is losing their way to find their way back?
Question was, someone who is saved, a verse for someone who is saved but
has lost their way, is trying to find their way back.
But lost their way, trying to find their way back. Yep. Okay.
And when you say trying to find your way back, I mean, I don't know. I would just say in general, the first thing that popped in my mind is the story of the prodigal. I think the story of the prodigal kind of sums up that there is nothing that we can do that separates us from the love of God. Just that concept is hard for us to grasp. I think that there's always things that, you said saved, but lost their way, and now trying to find their way back. I think when we stray, that can happen by different things. It can just be life stuff. It could be sin stuff. It could be whatever has kind of separated us from that connection, maybe that we felt at one time when we were first saved. But I think just that concept of no matter how far I stray, the Father is always there to welcome me back with open arms. I think that encourages me. So I would just say, just in general, the story of the prodigal speaks to me as far as finding a way back. That would be just me.
Luke 15.
Do what?
Luke 15.
Luke 15? Luke 15.
And for me, is this on? Yeah?
I'm on? I'm on it? Okay. First thing I thought of was Jeremiah, in that I don't always have to know what's going on or why sometimes I do the things that I do, because God knows everything. Whether I'm doing well or I'm doing poorly. He also knows if I'm trying to get back to him. So in Jeremiah 29, starting with verse 11, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me, and I will find, and you will find me when you seek me with your heart." Jeremiah 29, verses 13 through, verses 11 through 13.
There's another one here. This goes further back to the law. This is in Deuteronomy chapter 31. It says here in verse 8, "Lord himself goes before you and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you." So even, that promise was still for God's people, even before, while they were still wandering, in the desert. So whatever desert that we might find ourselves in, it's good to know that he's still, with us and for us.
Okay. Did you have? Okay.
The one I have, I don't know if it really works as much without context, but it was important to me because I, at one point, was that person. I fell away from my Christianity at a certain point. I had seen some things and that had made me not like Christianity so much. I still loved God, but wasn't so sure about Christianity. And it was hard for me to come back. At first, I was very angry at some people. And then, because I had fallen away and gotten angry at people, I got angry at myself. And Satan loves to whisper in our ear and say, "You've done too much. You can't do it now." The one that I had was, It's Romans, I don't know my chapter, but Romans in the verses 23, For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Because sometimes, a lot of times when we fall away, it's because somebody hurt us. Sometimes we have to remember we're people. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And when we have fallen away and we do those things and Satan's telling, whispering in our ear, you've done too much, you can't come back, we need to remember that's not possible, because all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. If everybody else is still okay with God, you can still be okay with God too. You can't, unless you just completely deny him entirely. And I thought I was at that point, but I remember very clearly having a conversation with Dean in his office one time when I was trying to find my way back, and I told him straight out, I'm not even sure if I believe in God anymore. And he looked at me and said, that's okay. God still believes in you.
Okay. For, I guess to me, the question is, do you want to come at it with love, or do you want to come at it with truth? I think in love, I think of the man, and this is Mark 9. He says, I do believe, help me with my unbelief. I firmly believe that, and I've been there many times. Whoop. Now, the other, that out of the truth, it says that, this is Matthew chapter 7, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. I mean, that's truth. So, I think the approach would be, what angle do you want to go at it? Do you want to go at it in love, or do you want to go at it in truth? And ultimately, we're supposed to blend in both. Okay. Questions. Don't be fearful.
Hey, everyone. So I started a new job, and so for me, I'm kind of struggling a little, but where can I look for more strength and knowledge, I guess, of being able to clear and open my mind to be able to absorb and learn?
That makes sense. Share that with us one more time, a little louder.
So I'm trying to learn this new job, and it's a little stressful and strainful on me. So where could I look for more scriptures for strength and knowledge?
In James, first scripture that comes to my mind is, if any of you lack wisdom, knowledge, wisdom, the things that go with that, ask God, and he will be glad to give it to you, not just a little bit, but the scripture says, to a great deal or in great abundance. So God holds wisdom. God holds truth. God holds knowledge for me, for us, for the universe. And if you want that, the book of James says, well, then just ask. God, I need wisdom, and he will give it to you, not sparingly, but greatly. So that'd be stop one. God, I need wisdom. And he'll say, okay, and he'll give it to you.
I would say the entire book of Proverbs is very profound in wisdom. I mean, if you just took one of those a day, for an entire month, you read the whole thing. But there is so many little the verses that just want to dig in on whatever it is that you're after. I promise. Proverbs, I would say, just take one a day. Anybody else?
So the Bible says to honor our parents, right? That's initially what we're supposed to do. Well, when you have a hard time dealing with childhood trauma that your parents have put you through, how do you honor them and still respect them when you don't feel like you can honor them, trust them, or respect them?
Well, I can answer that really quickly. It is, for many folks who have been attending CCC for a long time, have known for quite some time that I had major issues with my mother. Major. Had all my life. And I didn't think, really, that I was holding a grudge. But I really, really was. In fact, Miss Cheryl Black told me one day, "Dean, you need to forgive your mother. That's the critical component. It really doesn't matter what somebody does to us, because we want God to forgive us when we do things against him. And the Bible tells us that if we're not willing to forgive, then why should God forgive us?" So I had to let the burden go and forgive her for whatever offenses I thought she had caused me. It didn't mean that they just magically went away, but the hate and the frustration and the anger and the lack of forgiveness was gone. And I could see her then as somebody that Jesus loves. Forgiveness.
I don't necessarily hate her.
I didn't say you did, no.
I just don't want her part of my life anymore. I wish her well. I want her to be happy. I want her to have all the things that God wants her to have. I want her to have those things.
Pray.
Just without me.
Forgive and let God be God.
Yeah. Just without me.
Because God wants to work with her as much as he wants to work with you.
Thank you. The only thing I would add to that is, you know, the Bible really is full of things that are instructions from God that are sometimes hard to swallow or to understand, like the situation you're talking about. The Bible tells me to do this, but I don't feel this way, or the Bible tells me to do this, but I don't think they deserve this, or this situation, or the case may be. And sometimes I think we have to be reminded that, you know, ultimately as a Christian, when we give our life to him, you know, our life is not our own anymore. And sometimes just understanding that his word is good and that it always has our best interests at heart, and then remembering that in the end, I'm submitting to him and his ways. It's not just necessarily, you know, maybe I feel like this person does or does not deserve forgiveness, or maybe I think this person did me wrong or something like that. But in the end, if I'm living by God's word and I'm submitting to him at the end of the day, I'm really submitting to him, not to any person or really anything, because that's the whole point, is to live our lives worthy of the calling of God and to submit to him. And sometimes that does include things that aren't comfortable, don't make sense, but if we can find that place to do that, it always ends up being better. So I would just say, put him first in that situation and, you know, let him have his way there. So it sounds like you already had the scripture, honor your father and mother, and that's already on your heart. So, you know, I think it's just like God kind of unpack really the true meaning of what that means in your situation.
Kind of going along with that, in 1 Thessalonians 5:18, it says, "Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus." We need to be able to be thankful for our parents, and please understand, I'm putting this with a caveat. I understand there are some terrible parents out there. As a teacher, I have seen parents do some horrible things. And it's, you know, and I'm not discounting that, but the Bible is clear. We're supposed to give thanks to God in all circumstances, and that includes sometimes our crappy parents. because there is still something you can give thanks for them. The bottom line is, you exist. You would not exist without your parents. You would not have the life you have. You would not have your spouses, your children, your friends without, because there's a lot could have happened along the way. Bottom line, they could have chosen not to have you. They could have chosen, you know, they obviously at some point cared about you enough to at least keep you alive for at least long enough for CPS to get involved or something. The fact that you are sitting here in this room today says that they cared about you at least a tiny bit. And I know I'm probably picking at some wounds here because I know there's people who have some serious parental trauma. But you have to dig in and find what is the one thing you can give thanks for, even if it is nothing more than the fact that they at least kept you alive long enough to take your first breath so that you could make it here. And then let go of everything else. That's really where you be able to say, thank you, God, that I'm here, that you chose that lady and that man so that I could exist. And if that's all you can say thank you for, at least it's something. You're able to say thank you for that.
Yeah, it rains on the just and unjust. I think sometimes that word honor, we make it more than what it is. I can speak for my parents. Yeah, Mom's not here today, but I know she's listening. The lessons in life that I learned are some things I absolutely adhere to, and yet there are some that I do the exact opposite because of that. Well, number one, parents, it's hard, right?
Yeah.
But it doesn't change the fact that we hold that position as well as they held theirs. To honor, I think, more like someone who's in office. They held that position, whether you like it or not, to honor them for being able to, they carried that cup. And for me, the testimony is, even with my parents, to see them both saved was enough. It was enough for my life. So.
Can I add to that, or do I just need to ask another question? Okay. So I would agree with everything they said. Step one is to forgive. We have to remember that forgiveness isn't for them. You're not blessing her with your forgiveness. You are allowing the Lord to dig inside you and pull out those roots of bitterness and hate and unfairness and that evil that produced your living situation with your mother. Okay, step two is boundaries. It is more than okay. It is not just okay. It is necessary to have boundaries. Learn, and you'll have to work through it, what your boundaries with her are. What should the relationship look like, okay? And that's different for everybody. And it takes time, and it may change over time, so be prepared for that. Another thing is don't see her as your mother. She's a child of God. She is a broken person. Hurt people hurt people. We like to cling to the fact that that is the person in my life that was supposed to love me, and I got gypped. You got to let it go because it's not going to change. Okay, can't change it, but you can change your perspective. She's no longer your mother. She was never your mother in some cases, okay? I was the mother, okay? So let it go. You have God your father. You have your church family. You have people that love you. Cling to that and invest in those relationships, okay? I wish you the best. I love you. Been there, done that. We can talk about it for days if you want. Okay. My question is, can we talk about the confusion in the new generation of what is the truth? his truth, her truth? Why is that dangerous? What does the Bible say about it?
I could talk about that for hours. Ladies and gentlemen, there is no such thing as his truth, her truth. It does not exist. There is the truth. Now, we might have our version of something that happened. That doesn't make it gospel truth. Somebody else may have their version of the exact same situation, and it's radically different than this person's. That does not make what they just said the absolute truth. It's their version and their interpretation of something that took place. You cannot speak your truth. You cannot speak, a man cannot speak his truth. He or she can speak from their heart and their mind what has happened to them, how they've interpreted it, how it makes them feel, how they want to respond as a result. But it's not the truth. It's their perception of things. Jesus said, and I quote, "I am the way and the truth and the life." Not a truth, the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but by him. The truth is God's, period. And just because somebody says, "Well, that's my truth." Well, you're sharing your emotion, your feelings, your thoughts on something, but it doesn't mean that everything coming out of your mouth is exactly what took place. That's not your truth. There's the truth. There you go. I can talk about more, but I can't. I don't want to get me going. Okay. I'm done.
Yeah. See him after class. You guys mentioned this a few weeks ago on Wednesday, 2 Timothy chapter 4. It says, "Preach the word of God. Be prepared whether the time is favorable or not. Patiently correct, rebuke, and encourage with good teaching. For a time is coming when people will no longer listen to sound and wholesome teaching. They will follow their own desires and will look for teachers who will tell them whatever their itching ears want to hear. They will reject the truth and chase after myths. But you should keep a clear mind in every situation. Don't be afraid of suffering for the Lord. Work at telling others the good news and fully carry out the ministry God has given you."
Yeah, I don't really have anything to add to that. I mean, there's so many scriptures about, you know, God being truth, his word being truth. John 17:17, "Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth." You know, but you come to a point where you realize that in a scripture we also have so much prophecy to where we know there's going to be times where people think up is down and down is up. It's all throughout the Bible, and that's how, you know, in a lot of generations think, well, this is the last generation or this is the end time. But, you know, I just think that's the nature of you know, our carnal nature. And there's always been, I think you use the word, confused people, or confusing the truth and being run by emotion rather than God's truth. And I think one thing that we can take away is just understanding that is to be expected. But then I think to your point of bringing up in a situation like this is we didn't know as Christians how to respond. How to slice through the confusion, whatever we want to call it, the lack of truth, to be able to do our part as a Christian. While this is our generation, this is when I'm huffing air, and it's my responsibility to tell other people the truth, God's truth, and to make sure that you know, we stay strong through that. And again, as long as we're doing that, as long as we're sharing the truth in spirit and in truth from our heart, it's not our obligation to make people believe. I mean, you see that at, like, protests, right? I mean, I don't get a kick out of it. I just think, I look and I said, this is so silly. You think of any protest where you see one side's got signs, the other side's got signs, they're both screaming at each other, Ain't nobody listening. They are not there to be listened to or to change anybody's mind. They're there to be heard. Yeah. They're just going back and forth. What we need to do, I feel, as Christians, is to where we have influence, where the Spirit tells us words to say, especially where we can affect change, to be bold enough to do that and respond when God puts on our heart to do something and to speak with impact and speak with authority and to speak with the truth. And that's not our opinions, because we can get caught up in our feelings too. That's something we have to look at, is responding in a way as a reaction. Like, what they're saying is such nonsense and is so destructive, we just kind of sometimes lash out. We always need to come back to the center of, I'm just going to speak the truth, and that's what it is. I don't have to convince them, but I do have to share it, and I need to share it in a way that God, how God tells me to.
I'm going to piggyback and go back to the parent thing really quick. Those that know me closest, my mom's passing. She's maybe a year from cancer. It's not going to go away. But anyway, there's those feelings of resentment and pain and so on and so forth that I've forgiven as far as I can forgive. I think I've forgiven as much as I can feel inside, but there's always going to be that pain and the hurt from all those things that have happened. I don't know if that can ever be getting rid of. I've prayed about it. I still pray about it, and I'm pretty sure I will always continue to pray about it. But they're not going to be around forever, and you have to let go of that somehow and know that, you know, they do love you, and even if you don't feel that they love you, they love you. And you have to try and love them even through their flaws. Everybody has flaws. But I do want to say, too, I don't know how to help my son, because he has those resentments towards his dad, because his dad straight up abandoned him, just like my mom did me. So I know how he feels, but I don't know how to help him through that, because it's not me that can let go of it. It's him that I have to help him, guide him to let go of it. So that's, if there's some way that can be done.
Yeah, I'm just, so in case you didn't hear the question, the way I'm understanding is that she's saying that how do we help somebody who is struggling to let go and forgive? It's not necessarily us that's having the struggle, but we're watching someone that we care about with that struggle.
Are they saved? Well, it could be answered in the same way. Jesus died for many things. Jesus died for everything. Even if it doesn't come to a relationship healed, Jesus can be that relationship. At the same time, he died, and this is something that really, for us who are saved, and it's something that we may be struggling with, ask yourself this question. Was his death enough for that? If there's something in your life to where you truly, I can't deal with this, I can't forgive, I can't let go, I can't, was his death enough? And I don't want to be on the other side of that question to say no. But at the same time, maybe it's in him trying to pursue, or maybe you being the agent to help him pursue who this Jesus guy is, because he can do far more healing than it is trying to reminisce on the things that happened in the past. He can wipe all of it away. That. Mm. I'm gonna sit on that. I got something there. Hold on.
So with that, he, like I said, he's not saved. I pray for him and I try and talk to him, and I don't know how to get through. I don't know how to get through, because there's just this wall of, there is no such thing as Jesus. There is no such thing as God. It's a joke, and I don't know why you even believe in it. So even with prayer and talking to him as much as I can, he just laughs in my face. That's where he's at right now. I don't know how to help that one either.
Well, I think, you know, whether it's dealing with an issue of forgiveness or really any of those issues that we know are so foundational to who we are as Christians, those things where really they are beyond our power, that it is Christ working through us. We know we can't forgive other people without Christ. So expecting an unbeliever to have that level of grace and forgiveness is kind of, you know, it's just not going to happen. The best thing we can do for them is going to be living it out. And yeah, sometimes you can't have those conversations. They're not ready for those conversations. But you can live it out, and live it out in such a way that it starts to make them curious, because they know how hard it is. So when he sees you being forgiving, when he sees you being graceful, when he sees you being loving, when all worldly logic says that makes no sense, that's when people notice. You know, we're told to, you know, to live our lives in such a way that we're shining the light of Christ, and it makes people pay attention. And eventually they might laugh. They might say, that doesn't make sense. But they're noticing there's something different, especially when it's somebody that is as close as our children or our spouses, or, you know, those people who know us intimately, because he knows who you used to be. And it's going to start kicking in. Wait a minute. Mom didn't used to respond that way, and now she does. And he may not understand it, but it's going to be filed away. That's the best thing we can do for anybody that is unsaved, no matter what they're dealing with, is to live out our salvation loudly. That doesn't necessarily mean preaching at them. It means living our lives in such a way that they can't deny there's something different, because eventually they're going to want to know how in the world we are able to do that, because it doesn't make sense.
And just to make sure I understood, you're saying an unbeliever who needs to forgive someone and they're having it, and it's messing them up. You can obviously see it's messing them up because of the unforgiveness or whatever. I was convicted through something I read the other day, just this concept here, about the importance of being a Christian and being in tune, like, daily with, you know, just being in his word or you know, being living the Christian life every day. Sometimes we can look at a situation and say, oh, I know what I need to pray for here because it's happening. Like in your situation, okay, this person is struggling. It's so obvious they need to forgive this person to have some release in their life or whatever. But you also said we're talking about an unbeliever. And the example was used of, let's say you found out a family member was gravely ill. And as a Christian, sometimes our first thought is to pray for healing in their body, to get them on the prayer list to pray for their healing. When, in contrast, there is a possibility that God could put on your heart, you know what, depending on the situation, their time has come, and the best thing you can do is to pray for their spiritual healing, for them to be saved, and to pour everything into that. And that just kind of messed with my mind a little bit. Like, how many times have I done that? And that what God had said to me through that just spoke to me, what you said. Just search your heart for maybe your, I think this is great of what she said as far as living the Christian life and letting them see. Because, as the scripture says, you've probably heard, what good is it for a man to gain the whole world and lose their soul? And sometimes we think that in worldly things of, you know, maybe finances or to just have a good life, whatever that means. But, you know, for someone who's not saved, as Dean said for Philip's service today, the greatest thing that we can rejoice in is that he's saved at the end of the day. Take whatever life lived or whatever good or bad or whatever, at the end of the day, we can always say, hallelujah, we know the truth. We know the truth. We know what's going on with Philip right now. And I don't. I just want to share that with you because that spoke to me just as far as maybe putting so much pressure on you to fix this one thing where it's just search and just make sure that is maybe what God is wanting you to focus all your efforts on in that, because that's what I've been looking at, what I've been kind of looking at in my own life, reevaluating. So that was it.
I would consider you guys tenured Christians. What would be some reasons that you decided to stick it out? Because I'm thinking you're human, and you might have run into some roadblocks and difficulties and failures along the way.
Why are we still here?
Do you mean sticking out being a Christian? Like going through, like, when you say sticking it out, that's what you mean, right? Continuing to live the Christian life?
I'll ask the questions around here.
This is why we've decided to stick it out. when you know the love of God, and it's so apparent in your life that he has taken on so much from you, you know, in that moment. I mean, it's already happened, you know, it happened a long time ago, but in that moment it happens for you. And when you know and feel that love going on, I mean, how can you not? And I know some people have, their salvation experience is more transactional, kind of a business deal, which is good too, because you still know that you're loved by a good God, and you are forgiven for all the crap that's been that you have personally decided to partake in your life. So why would you not? I don't see laying that down.
I would say that the truth of, you know, when we are saved, again, it has nothing to do with us or anything that we have done. It is all by the grace of God. Because I will say, post-salvation, I was a kid when I was saved. I was 9 years old when I was saved. And I can say through my life, I mean, I wouldn't use the stronger term of saying I've given up before, but I mean, I've been separated. I mean, I imagine a lot of people have felt that way, like I've felt far away. And this is what I can say, no matter how far I've gone, God has proven over and over that he's never given up on me, because I have, let's just say, let go, and he continues to bring me back. Even if I stray, his spirit puts on me, hey, this isn't right, that isn't right, whatever. Whether I acknowledge it and take action on that, he's still stirring up within me. You know, it's a relationship, it's a bond that he will never break. And I think when I just kind of rest in that, you know, as far as hanging in there, whatever phrase you use, you know, I think there's different amounts of answering the call that we all do in our life as far as answering that call every day. But I would just say he's proven time and time again that he never gives up on me, and we keep finding our way back.
I stay just for you, Phil. No, I mean, well, you know, as well as many people in this room, especially people at this table. I was a different young lad. Thank you, Troy. I can't get life change from anything else. I can't get it from academia or work. I can't get it from the love of another. The only thing that I can attest that to is my journey with, I'll say this, and I said this on Wednesday in our little group. I know some people talk about God being a gentleman. I'm glad he is in your life. He's not that way with me. He's very much, you need to do this. You need to get your life right. You need to make this happen. So in that journey, it's been that situation of, hey, straighten up. Hey, you need to do this. And I could go back and think, my God, who was that? So that's why I feel. Plus you.
And I'll ditto that. If I can have a loving relationship and put up with Philip Fontes, I can endure. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Now, for me, I mean, this is actually a very personal thing. I mean, when you asked the question, I actually started tearing up because there was a point in my life where I didn't think I was going to still be here, both here as a Christian on the stage, but here on this planet. There are points in my life where I did give up. Those people who know me, you know that I have struggled with depression. I have struggled with suicidal ideations. And I did walk away from my faith for a while. And the reason that I am still here is because, like I said, like Dean said in his office so many years ago, I may have stopped believing in God. God did not stop believing in me. There have been times where I gave up on my marriage. There was times where my husband gave up on our marriage, and God said, nope, I don't give up on this. And we're still here. Your salvation really isn't about you. Your salvation is about the fact that God said, if you accept me, I'm going to do this for you. And God's a man of his word. That's why I'm still here. Because God said, I'm not done with you yet. That's why.
Next question, if everybody's had a chance to answer that. Good? Okay. So the next question comes from the internet live stream. So the person asks, how do you love someone who always seems to hate God and not want anything to do with God?
So at least they know him. Because you can't really hate something that doesn't exist. So you got at least something to work with. I would think that it wasn't God that would lead to that level of hate. Chances are it is an organization, like a church. Maybe it's a person within the church. Maybe it's a somebody who they looked up to that did something to them that involved the church. Jesus died for sometimes the stupidity of ourselves, sometimes for the stupidity of others. And his love is far greater than anything that we could ever muster. And to show that level of hate, in other words, there had to have been a point where there was either love, and that love was lost, and as well, there has to be knowing that he exists. So,
I mean, I think from the Christian perspective, that whole concept of you know, loving people who reject God is God's story. I mean, that's, he's a pro at that, of loving people who don't love him. And if he still loves, and I don't know what kind of relationship we're talking about then, but just love in general, if God can still love people who curse him and despise him or reject him or slander him, which they did when Jesus was walking the earth, they did it, I mean, it's prophesied about in Isaiah. He was despised and rejected by man, a man of suffering and familiar with pain. Like one from whom people hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him in low self-esteem. And this was in Isaiah, way before Christ's time. And guess what? That didn't change the plan. Jesus came knowing he was going to be despised and rejected and spit on and abused. So just that's what comes to my mind of he's already familiar with that suffering, and we don't need to really defend. Jesus doesn't need defending. Jesus can take care of himself. God can take care of himself. But we do, again, need to all bring it back down to we need to speak the truth. And if you're in a relationship where somebody is making you despise or reject God, then that's where you got to get back to the center and get back to the truth and get back to your first love, who's Jesus. So that's my only thoughts on that.
In thinking about dealing with people and love and so forth, people will say, there's nothing to love. Like, they're unlovable. There's nothing to love about them. A scripture that I memorized when I was probably 12 or 13 years old. 1 John 4, 7 and 8. Let us love one another because love is of God. And he who loves is born of God and knows God. He who does not love does not know God because God is love. Love, from God's perspective, is not conditional. God is going to love me no matter what I do. Doesn't excuse my behavior, but he is going to love me no matter what. So I don't have to have some kind of emotion to say, well, I just can't love that person. They're not producing anything love-worthy. Go back to the scripture. Let us love one another because we feel like it. Let us love one another because somebody's nice. Let us love one another because love is of God. And he who loves is born of God, and he who does not love doesn't know God. Why? Because God is love.
This scripture deals more with marriage, but it is talking about a believer and an unbeliever. And I'm just going to skip to the end of this little passage. It's in 1 Corinthians chapter 7. It says, I'm just going to read this part and say what I have to say. But if the unbeliever leaves, let it be so. The brother or sister is not bound to such circumstances. God has called us to live in peace. How do you know, wife, whether you will save your husband, or how do you know, husband, whether you will save your wife? So that's dealing with marriage, but I can imagine this could be the same in any kind of relationship where there's, you know, somebody that you're close to. You living your Christian life, you don't know really what effect that may have on that person. So, you know, love isn't always this emotional thing. Sometimes it's just, as a certain young man in our congregation says, sticking it out. You don't. I mean, if that person chooses to move on, you don't know what effect that you live in your Christian life would have on said person.
First Samuel 15:23 states that rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft or divination. I personally believe that is why the concept of my truth and all of these other political and social ideology, and a lot of it is so bizarre and contradictory to reality. But people actually believe these things because they have this spirit of delusion and witchcraft activated in their lives, and it's really caught on like wildfire, and the whole United States seems to be taken over by all of this very strange ideology that is not true and doesn't even make sense anymore, and it's rather embarrassing on the world stage, I think. But my question is, how do we as the church come against this very powerful and wicked sorcery and witchcraft? How do we pray against that? What do we do to combat this strange belief system that's just sweeping the nation? What do we do?
Very good question. And what you've stated is, in our country, a reality. It's almost the crazier it can be, the more people want to latch onto it. And it's the snowball effect, and it's crazy. One among many, is that people are no longer willing to tell somebody that they're delusional. We're not willing to tell people, no, I'm sorry, you're not a cat. You're not a cat. Well, they got to be what they got to be. The world in America, people's feelings and their touchy-feelies and their I think this is, whatever it may be, as wild and strange and absurd, to be proper, to be kind. Don't say anything. Don't hurt their feelings. Give them their safe space. Be gentle with them. Coddle them. They'll come around. What are they going to come around to if we don't share the truth? If I buy into, Faith here comes up and says, I'm a cow, because she loves cows. Faith, I love you, and I'm glad you like cows. You are not a cow. Right, Faith? Hallelujah. But that's just one example. The deal is, Christians, for the most part, that we're scared. We're scared of being canceled. We're scared of being called bigots. We're scared of being called hypocrites. We're scared of being called judgmental. We're scared of being called being mean-spirited. We're scared of being attacked. We're scared of being looked down upon. We're scared of not being liked. We're scared of not being wanted. The church needs to rise up and be counted and speak truth in love. Not just truth, because that comes across as a baseball bat. And not just love, because it comes off as a piece of toast soaked in milk. Love and truth go together. And then people can begin to see the light. My musings for the moment. And I would love to continue this until 6 p.m. this afternoon or evening. In fact, we could go till midnight. But chances are, you lovely and sweet and fine people who we do appreciate, all of us around this table and other leaders in the church, we're glad you are who you are, and we're glad you're here. And we're glad that you love God, and we want you to love God more. And many very strong and bold questions were asked today. We might not want to forget those questions that were asked. Ponder them. And what does the church, not just this church, the church, do next? And the big culprit of the craziness isn't so much the people that have gone crazy. Satan is a very formidable enemy. He desires to kill, steal, and destroy. in any form or fashion he can do it. God's the opposite of that. So may we side with God. And I'm going to close this out. If you'll stand up with me, please. We're going to sing one of my favorite songs. It's a hymn. I need thee every hour, most gracious Lord. No tender voice like thine can be soft. I need thee, oh, I need thee every hour. I need thee, oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. Amen. Have a great day.